We've been going through Philippians, and Pat did a great job last week. I loved his message, and he was very, very encouraging to us. it is a new year, and I want to take a Sunday to cast some vision. It's very important to do that. For the scriptures say, the body of Christ, for people perish for lack of vision. Vision is good. It helps us see maybe the direction that we are going, and gets us in one accord. You know, I've been teaching through, when I got here, we started Ephesians chapter 1 on purpose. And I went to Philippians on purpose. They're Paul's epistles to the church. You know, and you could never go wrong. God dropped me here, Denise and I, and we didn't really understand completely. You know, it's hard to get to know people, but I knew after praying that we needed God's word regarding the church. We could never go wrong there. And so we started there. And I got to say, since Denise and I, we have been here, I want to thank you guys. The last 7 months has been great. We have been welcomed with open arms and received far greater than we ever could imagine. This is our home. We love it here. We love you guys. And we're going to die here with you, you know, out here in the desert, unless the Lord tarries. This is home, and we're happy to call it home. It's been 7 months since we showed up, and there's been a lot of changes. Sometimes I get in the work mode and get kind of focused on just, you know, going to work every day type of, that's Roger. You know, I get up and go to work every day. And I don't think I'll ever stop doing that. But there was a time when I went into prayer recently, because sometimes I can feel like, wow, you know, Lord, in the flesh, I think, well, not very much got accomplished in 7 months. And the Lord said, you know, be quiet and sit down. Let me talk to you. And I was like, after praying, I was like, wow, God, you have done a lot in 7 months. You have done a lot. And you did everything you wanted to do and nothing that I wanted to do. And so that is God at work. And, you know, I want to say this. I think from the time that we got here, what we've seen and what our heart has been to bring purpose and intentive ministry, intentively, like with purpose, we want to do ministry. And that's not to say that Chris had all the ability to do all that, but that's hard when you don't have a full-time pastor, and when that pastor has to work and raise a family and all that other stuff. So that's been the goal from the very beginning, is with purpose, do ministry. And we've done that. We've cut some things and we've added some things, and I think there's growth in all areas of the church. And that, because of that, and we'll continue to do that. The title of the message this morning is Grow. It's the vision for 2017. But before you think about what I'm going to teach on, it's probably not. You see, the typical mindset when you think of something like this is you think of financial and numerical growth. We're going to grow this church. We're going to make it bigger and badder and more powerful than ever before. We're going to grow the church. You see, that's what the church of the world does. And I just really don't want any part of that. You see, none of that really amounts to a hill of beans, because I know that when God grows a person, he grows people. When God grows people, he grows community. When God grows community, he grows a church. He grows a body. And to be perfectly honest with you, I'm greater concerned about the church at large. We're pretty healthy. We're doing pretty good. Many of you are growing in your relationship with Jesus Christ. But at large, the church in America, and even around the world, in some cases, that's not true. That's not true. So this morning, when I talk about spiritual growth or growth for 2017, hear me. I'm not talking about the typical church growth sermon. It's my personal opinion that much of the Christ-centered church has traded in the growth of the believer in the spiritual sense and has adopted ministries and programs that are designed to grow the church from an external view versus a spiritual internal work of God. I view this as an unbiblical strategy, one that does not rely upon the power of God's word and the work of his Spirit. When God grows a church, it's always because he's growing people. Growing people. We're given a great commission to go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The church, not just the pastor, not the church leaders. And you know, that's not happening. Do you know why that doesn't happen? It doesn't happen because people don't know the gospel. They don't even know the word of God. And so the church at large is sinking sand. We've seen through our studies in Ephesians and Philippians, the purpose of the church, specifically in Ephesians, is to equip the saints for the work of the ministry. Equip them, grow them, grow. Feed them, feed the flock. Chuck taught, teach the Bible simply. And when you do that, do it again. And when you get done doing that, do it again. In September 2005, September 18th, I'll never forget the day, I was ordained at Grace Calvary Chapel in Hickson, Tennessee, with four other pastors after we had just finished an intense three-year discipleship program, like a hands-on seminary, like the School of Ministry at Costa Mesa. Boy, I'll tell you, through those 3 years, there was many times I actually thought about dropping out, trying to do that, do ministry, raise kids. You know, I don't know what I was thinking. I mean, I started a new business when we moved there to do this. I started building a 3,000 square foot house. I had little kids and started a pastor intern program all in the same week. Well, you know, I'm just glutton for punishment, I guess, you know. And I know this, that it was the hardest thing. When I look back on the spiritual growth of my life, it has been hard. And I say that with a smile. It has been hard. But God has planted me by rivers of water. And I take advantage of that. Take advantage. When God plants you by streams of living water, you take advantage of that. You grow. That's God's purpose and plan. You see, God, again, God's desire and plan for the church is that they grow spiritually. Now, for you note takers, do not turn there now because I don't want to take the time. But turn to Romans later, 12, and read that chapter with spiritual growth in mind, your spiritual growth, and see how it doesn't speak to you. Just a little activity for later on. We need to grow, and growing means increasing in our knowledge and practice of God, our intimacy, our oneness with him. But before we can ever do that, there must be first this spiritual rebirth. I can't grow until I'm planted, until I'm born again. We must not take the salvation God has so graciously made available to us and assume we are his without receiving salvation by faith and committing yourself to him, to your Savior. There's no growth. This is not about committing yourself to church. This is not about committing yourself to becoming a better person. I had a great conversation with my 22-year-old, I can't believe my kids are in their 20s. It's like, my baby's 22, and it just floors me. So I took her out on a belated birthday dinner, and we're talking, and she was sharing with me how she shared her faith with a coworker and her boyfriend when they went out to dinner just days earlier. And I was blown away at the things she was saying. You know, she was just telling, look, it's just about knowing God. It's about relationship with Him. This isn't about church. It's not about religion. It's about God, knowing God and being known by Him. I was like, whoa, you said that? Like, wow, you know? You know, it's like all that stuff over the years, you know, you put in them, it just comes out. I'm so impressed. But then the conversation went another direction, and she began to tell me, you know, Dad, our generation, we're really focused on just becoming really good people, better people. That's why so many 20-somethings, they look to Hinduism and Buddhism for good ideas, to becoming a better person. And that's why many times when you share the gospel with them, they'll look at you and say, wow, like genuinely excited for you. I'm so glad you found the light. I'm so glad you found the truth. I'm so glad that you have this inner peace. But they look at you like a cow looking at a new gate. When you say, it's not me. What are you talking? It's Jesus in me. Are you kidding me? You'll get this. I'm not looking for inner peace. I'm not looking to become a better person. I was a horrible person, and God made me a new person. This is the gospel. And she's like, I know, Dad, but that's not where they're at. And I'm like, so that's what they need to hear. I'm a new person in Christ. I'm not the same. I'm not a better old person. We gotta see our need to know God. And I think in the church in America at large, many people do not know God. They're coming to church, and I hate to say playing God, but they haven't received Him by faith. And so there's no present power in their life. This morning, do you know that you're known by Him? I'm not asking if you're a spiritual giant, but are you born again? Has God made you a new person? Do you understand, and can you articulate the gospel? Because if that gospel's changed your life, then you can articulate it. It doesn't have to be said exactly the same way I say it. But you can articulate the gospel of Jesus Christ because you've been changed by it. You're a new creature in Christ Jesus. Old things have passed away. All things are made new. And so this church for 2017 and all the years to come, it will be our purpose to extend the gift of salvation to everyone, every single person that comes through these doors, knowing that that's the primary work of God and work of the Holy Spirit. And after that, we want people to grow in their knowledge and trust and faith in Jesus Christ. And once we become born again, we are expected to grow. That's what the new, read it. And I think sometimes we go, I'm born again, I'm good. I got my ticket stamped, I'm okay. I'm good. And this is really prevalent in the South. They have a form of religion, but deny the power thereof. I walked an aisle, I raised a hand, I got my ticket stamped. Instead of living like heaven, I'm going to live like hell. It's a false sense of security. We need to grow. That's God's purpose biblically. Now, my story's not a miracle growth story, but my story, my growth is a miracle. When I look back at Roger, I'm just blown away. Like, you know, God, you're amazing. Do you still save? Yeah, look at me. Do you still heal? Yeah, look at me. Do you still teach the lame to walk and the deaf to speak and hear? Yeah, look at me. Look at me. That's my message. My growth has been slow and steady. And I tell you, I have seen over the years, the 28 years of walking with God, I have seen amazing things in others' lives. I've seen people grow, oh my gosh, like rocket ships, man. The Lord Jesus, come into my life. God, I need you so bad. Boom. And then like a week later, they're up preaching. And Jesus said, did you know Jesus knew? And I'm like, wow, I'm intimidated. I'm like, nothing like you. I'm like over here going, nah, just, you know, it's cool. I'm just stuck on John 3:16. I'm good. I'm golden. I'm good right here. You know? I've seen amazing things. God just do amazing things, amazing works of healing in people's lives. Both emotionally and physically and spiritually. God has healed. God has raised people up. He has gifted people with faith that's just amazing. Walk on water type of faith. I've seen people step out and trust God. Amazing growth. And we can easily say that it is a journey, isn't it? Now, I mean, this walk with God, it's got these high times, and then it's got some pretty low dips, you know? And I got to tell you, in 20 years, I've learned that it's my failures that God does amazing things with. That's his grace, not my victories. You know, those are great. But when God works in my brokenness, in my failure, in my lack, even in my disobedience, God works. It's been a journey. It is a journey walking with the Lord. And it is a walk of faith, secondly. It's not, let's just be honest. We have got amazing prophetic truth. Everything God wants to say to you and I is right here. And we're supposed to hold it right here and put it up in here. But listen, with all that, you can't take out the fact that this sometimes is just a walk of faith. God says, I need you to go and do. And you're like, what? You want me to do what? You know, I've got a friend in Tennessee. Super godly man, godly family, great friend of mine. A phenomenal motorcycle rider, so he's got to be a good person. And so, you know, but one time we were in his shop and we're just talking and his dad is like this spiritual giant. You know, it's like when he talks, it's like prophetic. And nothing's better than sitting like in an old messy body shop. His dad was in the body business and just talking about Jesus, you know. And Mark said to me, you know, he says, you're crazy. And I said, what are you talking about? He said, man, after you moved to Grace Calvary Chapel to do this intern, I learned of your life. He said, and what you left a business in California with babies and you moved to Alabama. You started a business and bought a house and built a shop and then sold that right when it was just getting good and followed God and moved to Chattanooga, Tennessee, where you started an internship, built a house, started another business in a week. You did all this, and then God sold that just years later. You come on staff, drop down to $36,000 a year as an assistant pastor, right? And then you break your leg, almost die, almost lose a leg, and in the process, you leave, sell everything, and go to Crossville, an hour and a half north, and plant a church in a wheelchair. He goes, what's wrong with you? This is before we gave that up and came down here. I said, man, it's God. I like having roots. But you know what? When God says go, man, I'm like, okay, let's go. And sometimes I got to slow down. I'm a little bit like a bull in a china shop, you know? I need to ask some questions first. Like, there's a few, you know, I got to apply in my older age. I'm learning to be a little more logical, you know? Hold on. Okay, I know you spoke. And God, I'm going to go. But can I pray about this a little bit more? I'm like, God said, oh, yeah, all right, let's go, pack it up, you know? And I'm taking off. And sometimes I trip a little bit on the way. But It is also a life of spiritual perseverance. Our spiritual growth is a life of perseverance. You got to hang in there. Amen? This is not for the weak of heart. Things get hard. You got to hang on. How many of you have just been at the feet of Jesus? You got him by the ankles and you're just, I'm not letting go. Maybe it's cancer. Maybe it's a struggle with a youth, a teenager. Maybe it's a marriage. Maybe it's financial difficulties. Again, more health issues. And you're just like, this is it. I mean, all you know is you got Jesus by the ankles and you're like, I'm not letting go. Everything else has fallen out from underneath your feet. God, I've been there. And you got to persevere. That's when your faith means everything to you. Grow. Spiritual growth is so important. And this is to be seen in biblical sanctification. 2 Thessalonians 2:13 says this, "But we are bound to give thanks to God always for you," Paul says to the church in Thessalonica, "brethren, beloved by the Lord, because God from the beginning chose you for salvation through sanctification by the Spirit and belief in the truth." Wow. Here, this word sanctification means sanctification of heart and a life. Our consecration and holiness. Oh, man. If you're growing, this is what's happening. If you're moving forward in your relationship with Jesus Christ, God is consecrating you. He's causing you and driving you towards holiness and oneness with him. The vision for this church is not numerical and financial growth. It's just, that'll happen. I'm not the least bit concerned. That is God's problem and for always will be. But I know this, if we are trusting Jesus and we are growing spiritually, man, we're gonna grow numerically. And God's going to expand our ability and purpose in our community. And we're going to fulfill the call of God. Just as a person has a call in their life, I believe individual churches have specific calls of God. That's why some are more evangelistic than others. Some really more focus on the spiritual gifts of others, you know, than others. Some churches, the worship's just phenomenal. And now, granted, you want to hit every base. You want to be hitting on all 8 cylinders as a church. But every church, just like a person, has their spiritual identity and their call and their purpose. We want healthy families and marriages, healthy kids, right? People that own their own business in this church, it's healthy because it's godly. Because you're growing spiritually. So, let's take a look at Acts 2. That was the biggest opening I have ever done in my life. So I've got like 10 more pages. So I hope you can hang on. I'm teasing. I don't have 10 pages. But I can make it 10. But I've got a sermon stretcher right here. So anyway, I think we need condensers sometimes. Some preachers need sermon condensers up on their pulpit. Condense that thing. So when the clock starts moving, you start skipping through. So let's look at Acts 2, beginning in 38. "And then Peter said to them, 'Repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is to you and to your children and to all who are afar off, as many as the Lord our God will call.'" It's still a whosoever gospel. Don't you love that? "And with many other words testified and exhorted them, saying, 'Be saved from this perverse or wicked generation.' And then those who gladly received the word were baptized, and that day about 3,000 souls were added. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and the breaking of bread and prayers. And then fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. Now all who believed were together and had all things in common, and sold their possessions and goods and divided them among all as anyone had need. So continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved. This picks up right here, you know, shortly after the day of Pentecost, and we have the birth of the church in Jerusalem. And it's easy to look at some of this stuff. Early on, what the passage that I just read, some of that happened instantly, right? Some believed. But the rest of that passage, that doesn't happen instantly. People having all things in common. You see, the text kind of stretches out. It starts out happening in the moment, and then it goes, and it stretches out. And so as we see the work and purpose of the early church. We see God at work, how he was growing the church. In the closing, I'm not closing my sermon, but in the closing of this passage, we see that it's God who adds to the church daily those who are being saved, right? And so we want to get jumped back up at 38 and pick up, and it says, and Peter said to them, this was his message, repent from your sins. Repent. The message is simple. The practice of the early church did not leave out the repentance of sin. You have got to turn from your sin and turn towards God. That means if you're living this way, you go this way. They repented, and it says they received forgiveness. Now, can I say something to you? For a child of God who is growing, they extend forgiveness. Look, you can smack me in the mouth and kick me and you know what? And come back and say, man, I'm sorry. I blew it. I let you down. I wasn't acting godly. And you know what I'll do? I'll forgive you and give you a big old hug. You know why? Because I've done the same thing. I've blown it with people. I've hurt people. I've messed up. I've let people down. And I can forgive because others have forgiven me. So that's the first. But secondly, I extend forgiveness because I know God has forgiven me. If you're not saved, if you're not grounded in the gospel, then you don't know that how much God has forgiven you. God has forgiven you. That means you can extend forgiveness to anyone else based on how much God has forgiven you. Growing people. Confess their sin. Often, not just a one-time deal. Lord, I know I'm messed up, you know, and then they just sit back on the laurels of their faith and just coast it. Like, wait, time out. It's not just about stamping the ticket, man. It's about coming to the Lord often and letting him evaluate your life in his grace, because you know he's good and he will forgive you. He will cleanse you. He will take you back in, just like that prodigal son. Every time. The enemy wants you to think that he won't do it. Every time. Do you extend forgiveness, Christian? Or is that an area you need to grow in? Do you know God's forgiven you of your sin? He's forgiven you. Verse 41. It says they received Peter's words and they acted on them, is what it says. And souls were added to the family of God right there in 41. They gladly received his words. 3,000 souls were added at the preaching of the word. A growing Christian is receptive. A growing Christian is receptive to the work of God. God's speaking. Are you listening? He's always speaking. God is always moving. He's moving in your life through the word if you're in it. He's moving in your life in prayer if you're praying. He's moving in your life with those around you if you're in fellowship. And he's adding. This is God just adds to the church simply because people confess their sin and started not only receiving forgiveness, but extending forgiveness. That is crazy. And 42 says, they continued steadfastly. This word in the Greek is pretty unique. It means they were adherent, devoted, constant, unremitting, even courageous in their constant readiness. Wow, what an early church. They were steadfast. Easy to pass over that word. They were steadfast in the truth, in what God has done, in the power of God. They were steadfast. They were adherent. They were holding on. They were staying the course. They were courageous. In what? What was their doctrine? What was the doctrine of the early church and the apostles? It says they were steadfast. They continued steadfast in the teaching of God's word. For starters, he says, God, I uphold my word above my very name. So as a church and as believers, we're going to grow. We're going to grow in our knowledge of this. No matter what stage, this is what's beautiful. No matter what stage you are in your life with God, man, this speaks to you. It's so profound. It lights you up. The simple truth. You can read scripture and it's like a meal that stays with you all day. It's God's promise to you. It's all a promise. It's all prophetic. It's all supernatural. It's all divine. The teaching of God's word. Martin Luther said this, the Bible is alive. It speaks to me. It has feet. It runs after me. It has hands, and it lays hold of me. The word of God. Right? Martin Luther, the great reformer. Secondly, they were in fellowship. Fellowship. God's people. Koinonia. Hebrews 10:25 says this. Not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as is the manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much more as you see the day approaching. They were in fellowship. Fellowship with God's people. Can I tell you something? You're not going to grow and you're not going to go anywhere unless you're at church, unless you're at Bible study, unless you come to prayer. You're not going to grow. You're going to come here when you can, when it fits into your schedule. And I'm not putting condemnation on anybody. I got to speak the truth. Right? Coming to church doesn't make you a Christian, but it does grow one. Right? It's like a heat lamp when you come together. And some neglect it. It's low down on the totem pole of priorities. Fellowship. Are you interested in it? Does it have priority? I love being around God's people. So much so that when I'm not around God's people, I feel like a fish out of water. Amen? They were in fellowship. We forsake this. Growing Christians don't. And I'm not saying you need to be at church every time the doors are open. Don't misunderstand me. But this church will grow because people are plugged in. Plugged in. Now, you know, we're not a denominational church, right? And we don't do a lot of voting around here because I just hate voting. I do. I think it's stupid. But I heard one Calvary pastor say this. You vote every time you come here. Every time you open that door, every time you open your Bible, and every time you put something in that tithe box, you vote. There you go. Now, when it's really important, we'll let you know. There'll be times coming up here soon where we're going to do something we've never done before, and that's have a church family meeting where we'll be going over the church finances. And you'll be able to look at it and see how awesome the church is doing. But better yet, next year you'll look and go, wow, God did all that. And the following year you'll look and say, and God did all that. Thirdly, it says that they were steadfast regarding communion. The breaking of bread. Communion. I know we're called to remember the suffering and the death of Christ. But we're also called to remember that we're to take his sufferings upon ourselves. A growing Christian knows when things happen in your life and they're difficult, that you're just becoming one with Jesus. Just like Paul and Silas when they were thrown in that Philippian jail. They started singing hymns and praising God. They counted themselves, just unworthy to suffer for the things of Christ. A non-growing Christian doesn't see the world that way. They don't know how to differentiate between the things they brought upon themselves and this suffering being for Christ. Communing with God, breaking bread, that's what it's talking about. Thirdly, the power of prayer. We become intimate, one writer says. We become intimate with whom we pray and for whom we pray and to whom we pray. We become intimate. You want to be close to God? Pray. You want to be closer to your brothers and sisters in Christ? Pray for them. Right? It's that simple. Prayer was an element of spiritual growth in the early church. These are practices of the first century church. They were devoted to trusting God to do what he wanted to accomplish in the church. 43. They were empowered. What happened? Fear. And that's an oxymoron. The church was empowered, and many signs and wonders were done through the church. When what happened? When fear fell upon the people of God. That word means reverence, reverential awe. That great fear. Fear is healthy. And we say the church in America has weakened. Many believe the church is weak today. And if there was one thing, I believe it's right here. We've lost our because we know how to do church. Oh man, we've mastered how to do church in America. Man, everything, right down to the T. But what have we lost? Not only in our churches, but in our culture, reverence for God. Reverence for God. If God rules your life, you've got this holy reverence for God. He's way up here. Your God is great, big, gigantic, enormous. And you revere him. That's why you serve him. It came upon every soul, is what the word tells us. And many wonders and signs were done through the apostle. This is the answer to a powerless church and a Christian who's not growing. How many in the church today are moved by the fear of God? A healthy fear. Many say that America has forgotten God. If indeed that's true, then it starts with reverence. It's a healthy thing. 44 and 45, they had this oneness. It says they sold everything and they brought it in here. Now, we don't do that. Why? Because if that worked, we'd still be doing that today. We don't do that today because it worked just for that time. But if we really look at this passage, what we do see is that they had a oneness, a unity They were others-centered, and no one had need. The church grew. People grew because they weren't concerned about myself. It's my income. It's my life. No, it's God's. You see, it was all God's. It's all given back to God. They weren't holding on. And I think that's a beautiful thing. That happens in Christians when you start to grow. You begin to hold on to everything. You know, I remember there was a time when I realized one day when I got my paycheck, new Christian in my 20s. A man signed it. But you know, this really came from God. This is God's gift to me. You know, and you know, before, I felt like, I just looked at it and thought, you know, all I could think about was how hard I worked and how much more I deserved. You know? But that's not the heart of a Christian. The heart of a Christian goes, wow, thank you, God. Right? Thank you, God. And God blesses that child of God. So, amazing. 46, they continued daily in one accord. Now, not a Honda Accord. It was one accord in the temple, in the house of God, back in fellowship, back under the teaching of the word. This word, one accord, literally means with one mind or one passion. You know, the Greek word is phenomenal. It's used 12 times in the New Testament. 10 of it is right in Acts. And it means to rush alongside of, really, part of it, to rush alongside of. It says they were rushing alongside of each other in devotion to God, to the temple of God. They were rushing alongside of each other in the things of God. Wow. That's what it meant, having one thing, one accord. I thought that was amazing. They continued together in worship. They rushed alongside of one another in worship. You can't neglect worship with your church family and be a growing Christian. This is why this is one of the devil's number one ways. Get you out of fellowship. Get you out of worship. Get you listening to something else on the radio. Stop admiring God for how great he is and start looking at all of your provision coming from somebody else. Just stop worshiping God. It's easy to happen. The growing Christian takes notice. And it says, and they grew in their influence in 47. And their community grew. Their influence grew in their lives. The unsaved grew. Their useful hands grew. God did amazing things through the church. Listen, guys, it's real simple. You've got to put yourself where God's moving if you're going to grow. K.P. Johann said this. I think it's on the screen. It is not Christ for me unless I am determined to have Christ formed in me. I think that's a great quote. In closing, turn your Bibles to 2 Peter 3:14. These vision sermons are always long. I'm going to wear you out. That's what we say in the South. Preacher's going to wear us out today. He's going to wore us out. He wore us out. He wore us out. Praise God. What am I doing? I'm just flipping mindlessly through the word. I had this marked for first service. 2 Peter 3:14. It's reminding you, Peter is writing to a church that is on the cuffs of experiencing great tribulation and difficulty. Therefore, beloved, looking forward to these things, be diligent to be found by him in peace. Be diligent. Nothing replaces the peace of God. Without spot or blameless. Wow. the knowledge of God, who I am in his sight. 15, and consider that the long suffering of our Lord is salvation. There's that perseverance. As also our beloved brother Paul, according to the wisdom given to him, has written to you. When you read that, think about all the things we're learning in Ephesians and Philippians. 16, as also in all the epistles, speaking in them of these things, in which are some things hard to understand, which untaught and unstable twist to their own destruction, as they do also the rest of the scriptures. But listen to 17. But you therefore, beloved, since you know this beforehand, beware lest you fall from your own steadfastness, being led away with error of the wicked one. Now, I don't know what your stance is on eternal security, but I know this. I know that this word here for steadfastness, right? That you lose it means firm condition or steadfastness of mind. Does it go as far as to say you can lose your salvation? I don't think so. But I believe that you can lose your steadfastness, your place with God, your closeness, your spiritual mindset, that firm condition that you stand in when you're closely walking with Jesus. He's warning them. Persecution's coming. Tighten up. Tighten up. And then he goes on in 18. But grow. But grow. What's the answer to this beware scripture? Grow. Grow. If you're growing, you don't worry about losing this, your steadfast place, your firm condition with God. That's not even in the back of your mind, because you're moving forward with God. But grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be the glory, both now and forever and ever. God is big. He gets all the glory. I've got a quote here. Grace is not God's reward for the faithful. It is his gift for the empty, feeble, and failing. And aren't you glad? Aren't you glad that you don't earn it and you don't deserve it? But it's God's gift. In whatever state, whatever place that you are in this morning, God's desire is that you grow in the grace, grow in how God views you, grow in how God sees you. You see, we see ourselves as messed up. We see ourselves as failures many times when we look in the mirror. We see ourselves letting God down often, not living up to God's standard, not doing enough. Guys, that's not what you came for. It's not what you came to. In the day that you gave your life to Christ, you came feeble, you came empty, you came broken, you came undeserving. So he says, listen, grow in the grace of God, because it will sustain you, it will help you, it will hold you. That firm foundation takes me right back to the gospel and the simplicity of who Jesus is. And so plug in, get involved, grow. Now's not the time to grow weary and lay down regarding women's Bible study. Now is not the time to grow weary and say, I don't, that men's Bible study looks a little intense. Men's prayer is just way too early for me. I could make it, but I'd have to get my lazy keister up out of bed. I might have to get up 15 minutes early because I'd know I have to drink 3 cups of coffee before I get here. Tim drinks about 8 cups of coffee before he gets here. Plug in. Let's pray. Lord God, thank you for your word this morning. I thank you, God, that you are at work in us, because you simply love us. And you have a purpose and a plan for us. God, that is to bless us, to strengthen us. And when I say bless, I don't mean in the way most people say it. God, you have great plans, but Lord, we want you. It's just simply, God, we want to run to you this year. We want to expect great things from you this year because we serve a great, big, awesome, enormous God who loves us more than we can ever imagine. God, would you stir us? Would you motivate us? Would you challenge us this year in our personal walks with God? Would you draw us close together? Would you unify us in you? Make us one. Help us, God, to take inventory of our life spiritually. Often, to confess our sin and to receive your forgiveness. God, because for no other reason, but just you love us. You love us. In Jesus' name, amen.